Hello, good morning. Welcome to 11s with Fran. It's Monday morning, and this is the beginning of our Dorothy Whipple week on 11s with Fran. Dorothy Whipple is one of the most popular writers at Persephone Books. Underrated, but so wonderful. Her writing is really extraordinary, insightful and warm and unusual and so clever, so memorable. Her stories and her novels, you can't forget them. So for those of you who are new to Dorothy Whipple, I hope you're excited. I know many of you are huge fans of hers already, so that's brilliant. So here's how 11s with Fran works. 11 o'clock, Monday, Wednesday, Friday, you go make a cup of tea and maybe get a slice of cake or a biscuit or whatever it is that floats your boat. I chat for a bit while you all wriggle around and get settled, yeah? And then I read you aloud a short story, right? Because it seems very unfair that it's just the children that get read aloud to. What about the rest of us, right? What about the rest of us being read aloud to? So I hope this proves a bit of a distraction, a calming, comforting distraction during these weird times. All right, you got your cup of tea? You sure? Cup of tea is very important for this. All right, today's short story is called A Lovely Time by Dorothy Whipple and was written in 1933. She got in from the office earlier than usual because she'd been lucky with buses. She thought she would write to Lucy to keep her mind off the cold. There were gas fires in the bedrooms at Vale House, but she was determined not to light hers until she was undressing for bed. The meter was a glutton for shillings and ate a great hole in her money every week. Only one light was allowed in the bedroom, but by means of a long flex from the ceiling, she'd made it into a bed lamp, which bloomed now like an orange in the dusk it created. She sat down under it to write to Lucy, who had remained at home in Ilkeston. "I've just come in from the office. It is a cold night, but my little lamp makes a glow and my little room feels very peaceful after the busy day. Oh, Lucy, it is wonderful living in London." "Yes, it was wonderful, especially when she wrote about it to Lucy, but her feet were very cold." She took off her damp shoes and put on her bedroom slippers. She settled herself again with pen and pad, but before she could write another word, there was a knock on the door, and in came Sheila Spence with her hair in lead curlers under a pink shingle cap. "Oh, you're in at last, Barnsley darling," she cried. "I've been up umpteen times before. You must help me out tonight. You must come out to dinner with me and Jeff Potter and Perry Gifford. Rosamond's just telephoned to say she's too seedy to come and I can't let them down. We must be a four. Do say you'll come. We're going to Bartolossi's and then on to a nightclub sort of place. You'll like the chaps and Gifford writes or something. Do say you'll come, darling." Alice, since she'd come to London, she spelt it Alice and pronounced it to rhyme with knees. Alice and pronounced it to rhyme with knees. She would have liked to do something with Barnes too, only it was difficult on account of letters from home and that kind of thing. Alice stared at Sheila while her poised pen deposited a large blot on the letter to Lucy. "Oh, Miss Spence," she breathed at last. No one had asked her out since she came to London. And now here was an invitation to dinner and a nightclub. Dinner and a nightclub. "You'll come then," said Sheila. "Cheers. Have you got an evening dress? Without sleeves, I mean. Well, get a move on, darling. I've had my hair in Queen Bess's since I got in from the office. What are you going to do with your hair?" She eyed Alice's lank locks with some anxiety. "I don't know. What can I do? I'll do anything," promised Alice. Sheila considered her. "Well, I think an Eton crop's your style," she said. "What about borrowing Shandon Stickit or whatever it is she uses for hers, and then you can plaster it behind your ears? Make it sleek and smart, see? Do you think she'll lend me some? I could pay her back tomorrow," said Alice, hopefully. "Oh, don't you bother about that. I'll go get it from her. She's in." Sheila knew she was in because she had first given her the invitation she had now given to Alice. But Shandon couldn't go, and Alice was Hobson's choice and must be made the best of. Alice hurriedly put away the letter to Lucy and fled to the bathroom for hot water. Then she recklessly lit the gas fire. The first time you went out with young men to dinner in a nightclub, you didn't stop to cavil about a shilling in the meter. Well, no, indeed. She sang as she took off her workaday clothes. fancy Miss Spence asking her. It was most kind, because she hardly knew her, really. And yet she'd called her darling and asked her out to dinner and a nightclub. Oh, London life had begun. She had been lonely, she had been dull, she had been cold, and felt the food at Vale House inadequate. But now the lights had gone up, the fun, the excitement, the experience she had come for were all going to begin. I say, said Sheila, putting her head in again, Dutch treats, you know, we're all paying for ourselves. That's all right, isn't it? Oh, of course, said Alice, snatching her cotton kimono. It won't be much at Bartolozzi's, said Sheila consolingly, but it's jolly good food all the same. Got any cigarettes? Oh, I'm afraid I haven't, said Alice. She didn't really like the taste of cigarettes and only smoked when she wished to be smart. Well, you can get some on the way. I'll take some too, and matches. Oh, I haven't a fancy box for the matches, faltered Alice. Oh, don't bother about that. Nobody has. Alice smiled happily once more and went on with her dressing. She was so glad she had the artificial satin cloak. It was strawberry pink and had a ruched collar. Lucy had made it for her to come to London with, but although she'd been in London more than 4 months, she'd never had it out of its box. Now she was going to wear it at last. She recklessly cut a piece out of the top of her winter vest so that it should not show above her black frock. Yikes. She knew she was being thriftless and in every way awful, but she was going to have a lovely time and nothing must spoil it. The brand new woolen vest must be sacrificed. She put on the black dress. It hung from her shoulders as it had hung from its coat hanger. In fact, there was little difference between the two means of support, for although Alice was 20, she was as small and bony as a child. She put on a string of pink beads, so pale as to be almost invisible, and draped a white scarf round her neck, finishing it with an elegant knot on one shoulder. Then she moved the bed lamp to the dressing table to do her face. No rouge, she decided, but plenty of powder and lipstick and eye black. When she'd finished, she hung over the reflection in the glass, looking for herself. She was almost unrecognisable, but rather modern and highbrow looking all the same, she thought with a thrill. Ready? Inquired Sheila, coming in to look her over. Sheila herself was highly coloured with dark curls, wet lips, green earrings and a full bosom. She wore a green gown and her black coat with a cat collar. Oh, Miss Spence, you do look lovely, cried Alice. Sheila didn't know what to say about Alice. Have you got the hair stuff on? She inquired to give herself time. No, I'm just going to put it on, said Alice, sprinkling vigorously from Miss Shandon's bottle. Oh, isn't it funny? It's like boiled starch. I expect that's what it is, said Sheila. Here, give me the comb. I'll do the back. Brush it very smooth. There. Well, I must say it's made a difference to you. Are you ready now? Yes, said Alice, snatching up the artificial satin cloak and her handbag and casting one more look at her unaccustomed self in the mirror. Come on then, we've got to meet them there. Alice put out the light and followed in the wake of Sheila's scent. The night was cold and murky, but although the satin cloak was thin, excitement kept Alice warm. They stopped at the corner for Alice to buy cigarettes and then they caught the bus on the Euston Road. See, said Alice to herself, sitting happily beside Sheila on the high seat by the door. Nobody stares in London when you go out in evening dress. She smiled to think what a commotion she would make in a tram at home in a pink satin cloak and no hat at 7:30 in the evening. She wondered what she could talk about to Mr. Gifford. She gathered that he would be allotted to her because Miss Spence was evidently keen on the other one. Alice wished she had read the latest works of the Sitwell family or been able to understand what she had seen of the verse of Mr. T.S. Eliot. At any rate, she had read The Good Companions. She smoothed her hair nervously. The ends pricked her. It even rattled a little when she touched it. But it was smart. She thought she might buy a bottle of that stuff when she could afford to. It couldn't be this week after those cigarettes. When you went out with men in London, they treated you as if you were a man too. Horace at home always paid for Lucy. She thought of Horace with some scorn. He wasn't really modern. He didn't quite know what was what. Poor Horace. They got out at Goode Street and made their way to the restaurant. It was ordinary enough outside, being merely two steamy plate glass windows. But when they opened the door, it was like stepping into another world for Alice. Her eyes fell straight away on an enormous man shoveling spaghetti into a mouth like a stoke hole. And as she followed Sheila to the stairs, a waitress called down the lift into the kitchen for panne, Panne, how thrilling. That must be Italian for bread. Panne, panne, whispered Alice ecstatically. Oh, this was the wide, wide world. This was even more than London. It was the cosmos. She would be able to ask for panne when she went home to Ilkeston for her holiday. We'll bide that table near the window, said Sheila. They don't seem to be here yet. Alice followed Sheila to a table for four and laid the pink satin cloak over the back of her chair. She got out the cigarettes and the matches to be ready, and they sat down to wait for the young men. Sheila took a mirror from her handbag and began to fluff up her curls, powder her nose, run a moistened finger along her eyelashes, and redden her already red lips. Alice took a look at herself in the mirror too, but as her face was still satisfactorily as white as chalk and her brows and lashes as black as coal, there was no need to do any more. Her mirror was so small, she could not see that her hair had risen at the back of her head in a stiff hackle, which caused amusement to people at other tables. She sat in bliss and ignorance, looking very small, young, and a little peculiar. Oh. This restaurant was a funny, hot place, she thought, but so exciting. That notice on the wall, Bianco Appasito, sixpence. Try that again. That notice on the wall, Bianco Appasito, sixpence. Was it a wine, she wondered, with that lovely name? Gifford's always late, said Sheila, and Jeff's almost as bad. Alice looked out of the window into a room across the street where they hadn't pulled down the blind. A little boy was standing on a chair to be undressed. His enormous mother played with him and his father stood by in his shirt sleeves. Alice felt as if she had looked right into life. Girls in black frocks and minute white aprons bustled past their table with bowls of minestrone and folded omelettes and unrecognisable but savoury dishes. Alice was very hungry, having lunch just on salad and a new kind of milk, and had no tea at all. At home, she used to have a large high tea as soon as she got in, but now she had to wait until 7:30 for dinner every night. She did it gladly because it was part of London life, but it often made her feel very queer. She did wish now that the young men would come and let her begin to eat. Still, she must wait, she must bear her hunger, she told herself, because they were the means, the cause of this lovely evening. They would come, dinner would follow them, and then they would lead their way to a nightclub. Fancy going to a nightclub. It had been one of her dreams, and now it was coming true. Oh, there they are, cried Sheila, jumping up and starting in pursuit of two young men who had turned down the room in the opposite direction. Alice took another hurried look into her mirror and as hurriedly put it away. Her heart beat fast. The young men were here, London young men, and one a writer. Sheila brought them triumphantly to the table. One had fair hair and the other was dark and dishevelled. Barnsey, Jeff Potter and Perry Gifford, said Sheila. And chaps, meet Barnsey. She's a dear and she comes from Ilkeston. Alice wished Miss Spence hadn't mentioned Ilkeston, but she smiled widely on the young men. Indeed, from now on, she smiled widely at everything. She was so happily excited that when anyone spoke, it was as if a string was pulled and Alice smiled. Now that the young men had come, things began to happen. Hi, Madalena, called Perry Gifford, making Alice jump. A girl came to the table and held Gifford's hand benevolently while they discussed the menu. Tornado or champignon is the best for tonight, she counselled, her kind dark eyes beaming on Alice, whose thinness roused her compassion. You all have tornado and sauté potatoes, yes? Alice agreed with the others, although she did not know what tornado meant. She hoped it was abundant and eatable. And four cocktails, asked Madalena. Two lagers, one glass of white wine, and for you, mademoiselle? Alice said water, please, and Madalena went to the top of the stairs to shout down the order, beginning with quattro cocktails and ending with acqua. Alice thought she would enjoy water as never before since it had been called by the name the Romans used for it. The dinner ordered, the young men turned their attention to their companions. Mr. Potter stroked Sheila's arms with one hand, while with the fingers of the other, he pressed in the waves of his fair hair or sought the spots on the back of his neck. Alice was conscious of the gaze of Mr. Gifford and was thrilled. Perhaps he would put her in her book. Oh, perhaps he would put her in her book. She began to tear the wax paper from the new packet of cigarettes to give herself countenance while under the observation of a writer. She did not see the look he transferred to Sheila before he turned away, a look that said as plainly as any words, How you had the nerve to bring me this. Will you smoke? Said Alice with a smile. He looked over his shoulder consideringly at the packet. Perhaps I will, he said. Alice put a cigarette between her own lips and, striking a match, lit first his and then her own. She was very gallant. She felt she'd copied Sheila very successfully. Men used to do these things for women, but now it was the other way round. Much newer and smarter, she reflected, and was glad she had not betrayed her provincialism by waiting for him to light up for her. She smoked very slowly, because she had read once that novices gave themselves away by smoking too fast. Once she managed to blow down her nose, but it was a great effort to suppress a cough afterwards. She decided to practice inhalation in the privacy of her room at Vale House. You write, don't you? She said in a respectful tone to Gifford. Sometimes, he answered indifferently. He did not encourage inquiries about his literary activities, which were as yet unsuccessful. What are you working at now? Asked Alice softly, in what she hoped was the right phraseology. I never discuss my work, said Mr. Gifford shortly. Alice shrank and looked out of the window again, but the little boy had gone to bed. Mr. Gifford glared balefully at the stiff poke of hair at the back of Alice's head, and again at Sheila, who just giggled and went on eating the middle out of Mr. Potter's bread. Something like a panic was going on in Alice's small breast as she kept her head turned away to the window. Whatever could she talk about next to Mr. Gifford? He was so Byronic and difficult, and the other two across the table were so engrossed with each other. Topics ran through her mind like mice, but she couldn't catch any of them. Aeroplanes? Or had you to say airplanes now? Music? But she didn't know anything about it. Theatres? But she hadn't been able to afford to go to any yet. Oh dear, she cried silently. What shall I talk about? What will he think of me? The eternal anxiety of youth. What will he think of me, not what do I think of him? Poor Alice. Echo, said the maternal voice of Maddalena, placing a cocktail before her. Alice smiled again. The dreadful moment was past. She leaned her sharp little elbows on the table and drank her cocktail with the others. Here's how, said Gifford. Happy days, said Sheila and Jeff. Thank you, said Alice. It didn't sound right, somehow. She was faintly worried again and wondered if there was a little book to be brought about the subject of what to say when drinking cocktails. But the worry was soon dispelled by the mounting influence of a cocktail on an empty stomach. Alice began to feel queer, but happy. She thought her legs had left her, but when she felt for her knees under the table, they were surprisingly still there. Reassured, Alice leant impulsively towards Perry Gifford. Wouldn't it be lovely at the nightclub, she said, beaming into his face. That is hardly the term I should use, he said without warmth. I should say it will be. He looked at her and left it at that. Alice felt rebuked for using such a word as lovely to a writer who must, of course, be particular about the choice of words. Lovely was a slack sort of word. You used it for everything, whether you meant it or not. She must be more careful in future. She smiled apologetically at Mr. Gifford. The scarf and the dress slipped a little and revealed one small bony shoulder. She left it like that and felt elegant and rather fast. She did not know her winter vest showed, but Perry Gifford did, and that, as he put to himself, settled it. Oh. Maddalena arrived with a steaming copper dish and proceeded to serve out the contents. Alice was immensely relieved to find that tornadoes were comfortable steaks with rich dark sauce and potatoes in rosettes. She smiled happily and began at last to appease her hunger. Mr. Gifford became engrossed in his dinner and did not need to be talked to, and Sheila and Jeff across the table were very gay together and held hands between mouthfuls. It was only by the exercise of great self-control that Alice managed to leave a little of the steak for manners, and the caramel cream she chose afterwards because it was the cheapest disappeared almost before she'd properly looked at it. We'll have coffee at the club, said Sheila, collecting the sums due for the dinner to hand over to Mr. Potter. Come along, Barnsey, we'll go and do our faces. Find out what Perry keeps mouthing to me about, she said in an aside to Jeff. I can't make out what he wants. Come along, Barnsey. Alice caught up the strawberry satin cloak and what remained of the cigarettes and followed Sheila to the tiny cloakroom, where the paint was labelled wet and they had to keep their elbows into their sides as they powdered their nose. "Wasn't the dinner good?" said Alice. "It really was excellent." "Your hair's come unstuck at the back," said Sheila. "Oh, has it?" Alice was alarmed. "Oh dear, what can I do about it?" "I think you'd better wet your comb and plaster it down," said Sheila. Alice thought she detected a faint coldness in her voice. But perhaps it was her fancy, because when she spoke again, Sheila was quite friendly. "I say, darling," Sheila said suddenly, "could you possibly lend me 5 bob for tonight? I'm getting short. You know how it is when you go out, and Jeff never has any money. I'll give it to you back on Friday, I swear I will." "Oh yes, Miss Spence, I'll lend it to you with pleasure," said Alice, blushing under her white powder at the embarrassment the other must feel at having to ask a comparative stranger for a loan. "It's awfully decent of you," said Sheila. "Oh, don't mention it," begged Alice, handing her 2 half-crowns and looking surreptitiously to see that there was still some money left. Lending money had not entered into her calculations for the week. "Now for the club," said Sheila gaily. "Oh, won't it be lovely," said Alice, squeezing her friend's arm as they went down the stairs to where the young men stood. As they approached, Perry Gifford walked off to the door. He even went through it. "These writers are very queer," admitted Alice to herself. "Sheila, one moment," said Mr. Potter, drawing her apart. Alice stood at the foot of the stairs, holding the satin cloak around her and humming to herself. "The nightclub, the nightclub. This is London, this is life." She looked at Sheila, listening to Jeff. When Sheila looked at anyone, she looked from eye to eye, from one eye to the other, very fast. Alice tried to do it to an imaginary face and felt dizzy. She hummed again. "The nightclub, the nightclub. What a lot she would have to write to Lucy about." Sheila was coming towards her. "Now are we ready?" called Alice, gaily, advancing. "I say, Miss Barnes," said Sheila, drawing her back to the foot of the stairs. "I'm ever so sorry, but Perry Gifford finds he can't go on to the club after all. He says he's got to go home and do some writing. You know how it is. If he feels in the mood, he has to go, hasn't he?" "Oh yes," said Alice, her face relaxing with relief. "If this was all..." "Well, you see," said Sheila, fiddling with her green earrings and looking from one eye to the other in Alice's face, which was stiffening again with apprehension. "Well, you see, that makes us 3, doesn't it? And 3's not much use at a dance club, is it? I mean to say, it wouldn't be much fun for you if you went, would it? You see what I mean?" Alice saw at last and blushed to have been so long about it. Oh, she said hurriedly. "I mean, I quite understand. Don't worry about me. I'll just go home." Home did not seem to be the right word. "I can go back," she amended. "I'm ever so sorry, Miss Barnes," said Sheila, retreating towards Jeff. "Oh, it's quite all right," said Alice. "Good night, Mr. Potter. Good night, Miss Spence." "Good night," said Sheila with a gushing smile, taking Mr. Potter's arm. Mr. Potter raised his hat a little way and with a wide, aching smile of her own, Alice left them. She got a bus at the corner and went back to Ensley Street. She opened the door of Vale House with the key attached by string and a safety pin to her bag and tiptoed into the hall. She hoped to reach her room without being seen, but before she had passed the great mirror in the tarnished gilt frame, Miss Taylor came out of the dining room. "Oh, hello, Miss Barnes. You're back early," she said. Alice smiled once more and murmured, "Yes," as if admitting to a crime. "I thought you and Sheila were going to make a night of it," cried jolly Miss Taylor. "Oh no," murmured Alice, slipping past her to the stairs. "Oh well, it'll do you more good to go to bed early," called Miss Taylor. Alice murmured again and reached the haven of her room. She took off the satin cloak, the black dress, the powder and the eye black. Her head ached, her heart ached, and she was cold. She couldn't light the gas fire now or for a long time to come. And she realised with bitterness that Sheila would not pay back the 5 shillings. She had protested too much. She'd said, "I swear I will." That meant she wouldn't. Besides, she looked from eye to eye. Alice hurried into bed to get warm, but before she turned out the lamp, she finished a letter to Lucy. "I went out to dinner tonight," she wrote, and then paused. What could she say? She thought for a long time, staring into the shadows of her narrow room. She would never be able to be gay and smart like other people, she thought. Never know what to say, what to wear, what to do. Never be happy and at ease. It was terrible. Terrible to be so lonely, to be so outside. But because no one, not even Lucy, must know that she had been thus weighed in London scales and found wanting, She wrote at last, "I had a lovely time." So sad. Really is so sad. And yet so subtle, the way Dorothy Whipple just slowly builds to the devastating sadness at the end. Really kind of heartbreaking in its incredibly low-key way. So I hope you enjoyed it. Is enjoyed the word? I mean, fun hearing about London nightclubs in the 1930s. Enjoyed it, or at least were moved by it or something. Lovely to have so many of you today. I'll do another Dorothy Whipple story this Wednesday and this Friday. So join me for those. Hope you enjoyed your cup of tea. This was 11s with Fran, and I'll see you soon.